From Washington, I'm Robert Christian, and on the first hour of today's show, stand-up comic, motivational speaker, and actress, author Karith Foster will be joining us. Karith Foster is her name. Yes, yes, Karith. I got it. She has also been seen on ABC Television, BET, Bravo, MSNBC, and has appeared on WABC in New York City, among other media outlets. We're going to be talking with her, folks. She is a woman on a mission, and let's try to make it a little bit lively. First, here is some of the news that we're looking at in our rearview mirror. From Washington, President Barack Obama will deploy a small number of American Special Operations Forces to the Kurdish-controlled country of northern Syria, a United States official has said. The White House is expected to make an announcement on Friday, according to the news report. Coming out of Florida, a National Transportation Safety Board investigates what caused a dynamic airline jet to catch fire at the Fort Lauderdale International Airport. The airport officials are now releasing information about it, stating that some 20 people have been injured. The plane, a Boeing 767 bound for Caracas, Venezuela, caught on fire while taxiing for departure, according to the FAA. A new report says that approximately half of U.S. employees work in states or counties that are less covered by anti-gay discrimination employment protections. We're going to be getting into this news story a little bit later. MAP says that 51% of the U.S. population protected by LGBT-inclusive workplace laws are raising to 56% protected by LGB-inclusive laws. Again, we're going to be getting into that and what MAP actually is. Speaking of MAPs, we're going to be looking at U.S. Senator Ted Cruz, Louisiana Governor Bobby Jindal, and former Arkansas Governor Mike Huckabee. All of these Republicans, well-known anti-gay political views, have they? Yup, you betcha. But get this. The three Republican Party presidential hopefuls have agreed to speak at the National Religious Liberties Conference organized by Kevin Swanson, a pastor who frequently has said that gay people should, in quotation, be killed. I'm Robert Christian. Stay tuned for the Robert Christian Show up next. Here we go.
You're watching the Robert Christian Show. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Greetings, everyone. Hey, welcome to the show. Let's try to make it a little bit lively. You know what? We have a very, very funny lady. Motivational speaker. You know, I think she's talented. Nonetheless. Thank you. Thank you for that. Oh, good grief. Hey, Karith Foster. It is great to see you.
It is great to be seen.
You know, like I said, I was watching, folks, if you haven't looked her up yet on YouTube, do so. You had a video, and I've got to poke fun at this little video just for a minute. That you did because you were talking, a part of your skit that you were doing was talking about having an intervention at a barbecue. And that was so funny that immediately got me to laughing.
The setup to the joke is that I talk about how it depends on which part of the country I am, how I'm supposed to feel about my body. Because if I'm in New York City, where I am now, I'm pleasantly plump. If I'm in Los Angeles, I'm a beach whale. But if I'm in the Midwest, I'm anorexic. And I got off a flight, and my friends were like, oh my God, you're wasting weight and nothing. And that's when they threw the barbecue intervention, and it was delicious.
Well, I bet. You know, you don't look like you're heavy set. You don't look like you're anorexic. You look great. What else can I say? Me, on the other hand, I mean, I've got some hail damage going on, and I'm like, oh my
God.
Stop it. So, hey, I think it's great. But, you know, when I was contacted by your agent, I thought, you know, this would be an interesting interview, a good deal. And then I found out later what your actual sheet is.
Mm-hmm.
Your bio, places that you've been, different networks that you've been on, they are keeping you quite busy, aren't they?
I've been keeping myself busy. I've been keeping myself busy. So you kind of have to, you know?
Well, that's great. You know, now getting into the meat of it, you know, I think that people do need to get busy and remain doing what they do to help the world, you know, to change the world one person at a time, one moment at a time.
Absolutely.
But do you find, I mean, we can, of course, laugh at a lot of stuff in life, which is good for the soul. But do you find that people need to laugh more?
Oh, without question. I mean, people are so serious, and they take things so personally. I'm actually in a movie that's coming out. Its world premiere is November 13th here in New York City at the New York City Documentary Festival called Can We Take a Joke? And the idea behind it is, you know, it started from a conversation one of the producers had with a friend who's a comedian who said he no longer wanted to play college campuses because no longer could he tell the jokes he wanted to without someone coming up saying they were offended. And back in the day, you know, it used to be, I think Carlin, they even have a clip of George Carlin saying this in the film. It was the conservatives who were the uber, you know, word police. Now it's the liberals who've just gone way completely over the top with, you know, oh my gosh, you can't say that joke because my cousin's nephew's brother is a gay Muslim and I'm offended for him, you know. And the idea, at least for me, is that so many things out there that are horrible, like racism and homophobia and misogyny, are laughable because they're so awful that we need to, like, the fact that they even exist makes no sense. So I like to use laughter as a way to draw attention, A, to that fact, but B, to also break down the walls so that people who are normally uncomfortable talking about those types of issues kind of have that wall broken down so that there's a comfort level across all areas so that people can have a real discussion. And if you can laugh about it, you can think about it, and then you can talk about it, and then you can act.
You know what? You nailed it. You absolutely did. I mean, if you really think about it, because what I find a lot of times is I mean, I, for one, I like to make people laugh and enjoy things. But part of that, for me, it is sort of hiding behind humor because of the pain that I've had in my life.
Of course.
And
any comedy, go ahead.
So, would you say that the same goes for you as well? That it helps to maybe cover up or to shield you from I don't know, from the bad?
Well, it's not that it's a shield. I mean, for some people it is, absolutely. That's what, I mean, you always hear about kids who got picked on in school who became the class clown, or, you know, so many comedians have that experience. I didn't per se, you know, I was in a pretty fortunate situation where while I was kind of an outsider, as in there were 1,200 people in my graduating class from high school, 12 of us were black. I was literally part of the 1%, not the 1% we hear about in the news, but
yes,
just another 1%. And, you know, it wasn't always comfortable. It wasn't always pleasant, and at times, it was painful. And so I joke about that now. I put that in my act, and I joke about it to you know, to shed light on the topic. And a lot of times, I get so many responses, especially from other students in my courses, or my classes, or my presentations, who also understand that, you know, it's okay to have been there and to have been uncomfortable, but you aren't what your experiences are. You're not an outcast for whatever reason. That's why I created this program called Stereotypes 101 that I take to colleges and universities. And the idea, well, the catalyst for that was when about 4 or 5 years ago now, Tyler Clemente, a Rutgers University student, was outed by his peers and roommate, and it took his own life by jumping off the George Washington Bridge. And I remember thinking, like, nobody, it's 2010, first of all, nobody should feel that alone for who they are. You know, nobody should feel that badly or that isolated for whatever reason, their sexuality, their ethnicity, their socioeconomic status. So, you know, my thought was, how do I create a program to help people? And, you know, I thought of my gifts, and my gifts are as a comedian, you know. So I'm like, okay, what do I do with my comedy and then getting the message across? And I figured it out, and I created a program that I get to take to schools and colleges and even, you know, some high schools. You know, I'll present to any age audience. But it's the message that people need to hear. And I have since developed a different version, same message about acceptance and respect and taking care of one another for corporations.
Now, you are, as you had mentioned, you have taken this new, I guess it's a new road, so to speak, in your career and what you are about, what you're wanting to do beyond just standing up at a club and making people laugh and enjoying themselves. But there is a very serious side to you.
Oh, absolutely.
So how is that message? I mean, obviously, you know, I can understand the difference between your comedy routine that you would do or being very serious. But for you as a person, would you prefer a crossroads where you can use comedy along with, you know, being serious at the same time?
That's what I do. But that's what I do. I use the comedy, and I also address the sensitive topics. But that's how I get to the sensitive topics, because it is so uncomfortable for so many people. And a lot of people don't want to speak up. They don't want to share, necessarily, because they're intimidated, they're frightened. There may be anger, depending on which side of the coin you're on. So the idea is, if you can get people to laugh, you can get them to open up. You can break that wall down so that they can share their experience. And you know, as a diversity engagement specialist, that's what I do. I create a safe space using humor as a tool for people to share their experiences. And the idea behind that is, if we can develop something that I've coined called conscious empathy, truly understanding, or trying to understand at least, putting energy into understanding where other people are coming from, then we're one step closer to... Go ahead.
I was thinking that you remind me so much, and I want this to go over like really good with you, but you remind me so much of Joan Rivers.
Really?
Because Joan, you know, seeing her on stage, that was one thing, but for anybody that knew her, or anybody that ever had the opportunity to interview her, to go to one of her shows even, yeah, sure, there was some slapstick stuff going on. But you know what? Her underlining message that she always left with wasn't necessarily a funny one.
Mm-hmm.
There was
mm-hmm.
something very serious about her. And
when, she had a lot of pain in her life.
Well, she did. But you know what? Through the pain, people saw a gem.
Exactly, absolutely. And that's exactly what it's all about. Everybody is a gem. You know, they just need to figure out how they're going to shine.
So you mentioned colleges and places that you go to. Mm-hmm. What are some upcoming dates if people wanted to look you up and to find, hey, this is where she is? Are you there? Okay, I think that we might have lost our guest. Ladies and gentlemen, we are going to let us take a short break, ladies and gentlemen, and we'll be back with more of the Robert Christian Show, live from Washington. Don't go too far.
Hi there. I am so sorry. I don't know what happened. Gatorade break. Your next sponsor.
Yeah, no doubt. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the show. And Karith Foster, you know, I don't know what happens, but every great now and then it'll, anyway, they got to do something about that. But anyway, we're talking about Joan Rivers.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that compliment. I take that as a huge compliment. She was an incredible woman, and very smart, and very bright, and quite a business woman, an entrepreneur, and a visionary.
I think you are, too.
Well, thank you.
Because, you know, not everybody, well, not just anybody, let me word it that way, not just anybody can cross the funny road and get on the serious road, or mix and mingle between the two of them. That takes extreme talent. You know, you're talking about bigotry and racism in America. How have those things affected you?
Well, being a black woman, some of it has been indirect, a lot of it actually. I did actually have someone on LinkedIn when I posted that I was a diversity engagement specialist use the N-word toward me, which was probably one of the first times in my adult life that's ever happened. This is also, I believe, someone who's a little psychotic. But there have been more indirect things, like, you know, when I first started out in comedy and I had, I would be sent out on auditions and I would go out for African-American voiceover parts. Well, if you close your eyes and you didn't see what I looked like, you would never guess that I was black because I don't fit the quote-unquote stereotype of an African-American woman. So I'd go out for these auditions and they'd look at me and then they'd ask me to read the lines and then they'd say, can you jazz it up a little? You know, we're going for an urban sound. I'm like, so what, you want me to scat, jazz it up? What are you talking about? So, you know, it's things like that where I found that people wanted to pigeonhole me and put me in a category just because I had more melanin than they did. You know, I had a better tan.
Right.
And, you know, I believe I've been a success in comedy because I didn't go into it thinking, oh, they're not going to like me because I'm a woman or because I'm black. I've always thought they're going to like me because I'm funny. Now, if they have issues with other things, that's their personal problem, right? If they don't find me funny, that's fine. Comedy is subjective. But, you know, on the other hand, also, if they're looking for a black female, I'll be the first in line and say, hey, here I am. But I've never used it as a crutch or as an excuse. And so I don't feel like I've ever been treated in a way that it was. You know, I believe how we project who we are is how other people will treat us. And that's a lesson that a lot of people need to learn. You know, it took me a while to learn it. I was forced to learn it because growing up, I was the only black person in any of my classes. It continued even through college. I always had to be okay being Karith because I couldn't be what other people wanted me to be.
Well, you know, you can be what everybody, you know what, I've learned this, that you can be what everybody else wants you to be. But if you did that, you would be neglecting who you are. You know, if you are a business owner and you're focusing your business and your business model on somebody else down the street, your business is never going to stand out on its own.
Exactly.
And Karith, you know what? You do that. You know, I watched that video and I was laughing. I thought, you know what? This is great. She's on target, and you are.
Thank you.
So what is your ultimate hope and your goal with what you're doing now?
Well, the esoteric version is to just, you know, keep making the world a better place. But, you know, ideally, I'm a mother now. I have two small children, and I love spending time with them. I love being with them. I want to create a life that we get to spend time together. We get to travel. I get to expose them to other parts of the world, other cultures. They're half Australian, so I want them to spend time there with the other side of their family. But I, you know, the sky is the limit. You know, I love speaking. Obviously, I love entertaining. I'm working on a book right now, hopefully out this spring, called You Can Be Perfect or You Can Be Happy. The choice is yours.
Right, right.
So, it's, you know, I who knows, you know, radio show again. I was on the air with Don Imus for a couple years on morning radio. I enjoy doing that. A TV show isn't out of the question. I'm open for it all, you know.
You know, everybody in America knows who Don Imus is. You know, I mean, he's now, isn't he on Sirius FM now or XM? I think that's what he's on. Are you there?
Me?
Yes.
Oh, I don't know if he's on Sirius right now. He was on WABC. Howard Stern is on Sirius. Howard's been on, you know, Sirius for a while. Like, they built Sirius XM on Howard. As far as I'm concerned, I'm not sure if he's there.
Now, he's outlandish. He really is. Have you been on his show?
Howard? Uh-huh. Yeah.
Wow, what was your impression?
I actually really enjoyed him. He was very kind. He had me on because he hated Imus, so he wanted to hear what happened.
You know, what I think is so interesting about you, as we were talking earlier on, that being in your chosen career and living in New York and in L.A., that is the two best markets to live in. As far as with what you're doing, and if you are in the radio market, you know, hey, still, if you're in television, that's where you'd want to go. I lived in Los Angeles for a few years there, and I hated it. No offense to Californians, but I hated L.A. It was just, to me, it was horrifying. So I moved to Seattle 20-some-odd years ago, and I've been here ever since. You know, but I think that what it is, Karith, is that when you are exposed to massive markets like that, you know, it's amazing because it does an awful lot of things for your career.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And having drive does. I mean, there are people who can come here and do nothing and nothing happens. You know, yes, location is most certainly a benefit. You know, you have to be the one who's pushing yourself. You have to be the one who's out there, you know, making things happen. I figured that out, you know, however many years in this business, having managers and agents. And, you know, while I do believe most of them want to help you, and it's in their heart to do so, nobody's going to work harder for you than you. That's just how it is.
Okay, what is then about you that gives you that drive? I mean, you mentioned family, which that is important.
Right, and even before kids, you know what it is? Honestly, Robert, it's the whole, and like when I was charged with deciding whether or not I was going to join IMIS, and that was after the very, you know, media, the scandal about the, you know, Rutgers Women's University disparaging remarks, and I had to decide, is this something that I want to do? Is this something I can do? You know, some people accuse me of selling out by taking the job, but I remember thinking, if I don't do this, someone else will, who may not be as responsible with this position. You know, I took it as an opportunity to be a representative of a group of people who his audience had probably never even interacted with. You know, most of his people who listened to him and watched him probably did not know any young, black, articulate, funny, smart women. So, you know, this was my chance. And unfortunately, it ended on a bit of a rough note because he too wanted me to be the voice he couldn't be. But the whole thing behind my success is, you know, the whole wondering what if I don't go for this? What if I don't push myself? I couldn't live with myself. To me, that's hell.
I can identify with you. You know, even here on my show, I was asked a few years ago if I would sell the show. Believe that. And I was like, no, I don't think so. No, that's simply not going to work. I've had other people that have said, you know, why are you still hanging around? Why aren't you dead and in the ground, buried, you know, 10 feet under? What's keeping you alive? But really, it's a drive. It is something that is within you, and Karith, you're showing that not just on the stage as a comic, but as a motivational speaker, and which that can become quite serious quite quick.
Yeah. No, some really great things are happening literally like right now. So, you know, touch wood, fingers crossed that it really takes off, but. Yeah, I've been very blessed. I lead a pretty charmed life. Like, I meet the right people at the right times, and things fall into place. Of course, you know what they say, the definition of luck is when preparation and opportunity meet.
That's true. And you know what? Opportunity has come knocking at your door, and you've answered it. You've opened it, and you said, hey, here am I. I have something to say. I have something that I want to focus on, and you've done that. I think that you do very well.
Thank you.
I mean, I was looking at your videos and like, oh my God, why didn't I come up with something quite like that? You know, well, it wasn't meant to be. I don't know. Maybe I was just meant to be an old fogey somewhere, you know? But you know what? I think it's divine what you're doing, and wanting to motivate other people in their life. So if you had a single message, this is going to be a hard question, but if you had a single message for the world, what would it be?
You know, I just redid my website, which is Karith.com, by the way.
Yes, yes.
I'll get that plug in there. And, you know, it's I thought of that instantly because one of the, you know, I was like, well, how can I put what I believe and what I want other people to believe in a quick, you know, fast message? And on my website, it says, be you, be limitless. And I believe that only we are responsible for limiting ourselves. And as far as we can go. And you should be able to be who you are. Be true to yourself and do that. So, you know, and that is part of being true to yourself, is not putting limitations, not letting anyone else limit you, and not putting limitations on yourself. So that's the message for the world.
Well, do you think that people put limits on themselves, as you mentioned it, because of a fear?
Absolutely. I think almost everything is fear-driven, quite honestly. I think racism is fear-driven, sexism is fear-driven, homophobia is fear-driven. It's all about fear, fearing what we don't know, fearing what we're uncomfortable with, you know, fearing something that's new. It's all about fear, and if we can replace fear with love, you know, and that doesn't even mean you have to agree with someone's lifestyle or their religion. You don't have to agree with it, but you have to respect it and understand that they're entitled to that. So yeah, fear, I mean, fear is a very powerful motivating force. I also think that, you know, I have a talk that I give called You Are Enough. And I think everybody has an enough, something they're like, oh, I'm not tall enough, I'm not smart enough, I'm not quick enough. And I think it kind of starts when we're little kids. And I don't believe it's maliciously intended initially. I think it's, you know, when parents say, oh, honey, you know, you're not old enough to stay home by yourself, or you're not, you know, big enough to cross the street without holding hands, all of those things. So that's one thing I'm very careful to never say to my children. I never use the word enough or not enough. I say, when you're older, you can do this. When we get to this point, you can do that. Because I think at some point, that little not enough recording becomes ingrained in our brains, and we adopt it for ourselves. And then we think, I'm not pretty enough to be a cheerleader. I'm not smart enough to apply for law school. You know, all these things that keep us from doing things that is in our heart and in our mind. And if you think it, you can do it and be it. Like, otherwise, it wouldn't have even been a thought.
You know, a good question. Thanks for the question in the chat. But Karith, when you were a little kid, what did you want to become?
I was a very sick little kid. I had horrible asthma and allergies. So in the very beginning, I wanted to be a pediatrician. I wanted to take care of people. I wanted people to feel good. I still want people to feel good. You know, that's why I do what I do with my comedy. I feel like I heal in another way.
Do you ever reflect back on that and wonder, you know, if I would have taken that road to become a pediatrician, what would my life be like today?
Well, since I am not that big a fan of medicine, I only use natural oils and organic foods for stuff, I probably wouldn't have much of a medical license.
Well, you know,
I'd be the alternative doctor, the alternative pediatrician. I'll tell you this. When I was three, I'll never forget watching Sesame Street. And there was a little girl sitting on a brick wall with Grover. I don't know if they're doing the alphabet, they're doing numbers, but I remember watching it at three going, I should be on that brick wall. I should be doing that.
You know, I always wanted to be on that show. I really did as a kid, you know? And I mean, everything was happy, and the you know, singing characters and all this. And, you know, that's really what you wanted to surround yourself with as a kid.
Yeah.
You know, but and now today, you know, our lives have completely turned around from what that it was when we were kids, or what we'd like to have become. You know,
I am in front of the brick wall, so I can't really.
Yeah, true. Just a different one, you know, a different light on it.
There's not a Snuffy in the picture.
You know, I always wanted to be the man on the radio. You know, I remember back when I was in like fourth or fifth grade tearing radios apart, transistor radios, to try to find out how that they worked and what made them work. Well, I'd tear them apart and put them back together and they'd work again. Those are the good old days. But so I guess in a way I was a geek, maybe.
Sure.
A little one. But I didn't, you know, that's not what I wanted to become later in life. It was to be a geek, no, but I get around. But, you know, I've always enjoyed, though, making people laugh, finding something funny at least once a day to laugh at, and just to enjoy time, you know, with a sense of humor. Mm-hmm. Where does your humor come from?
Oh, gosh. Well, I would say a great percentage of it is personal experiences. You know, God, there's nothing like having family to give you material.
True, true.
Friends, observations. You know, most of my material doesn't come from a dark place. I'm not a comic who's out there, you know, to work out a therapy session. I like to share my experiences, even the ones that do come from pain, but the ones that are, like, funny and happy and... You know, I mean, there's some things that happen in your life that's like, this is just ridiculous. Like the birthday present my husband gave me when I was 6 months pregnant. Anybody who's listening, I don't know how many pregnant people you have listening or who have been pregnant or known pregnant people, but your body does not function the way it normally does, and things get blocked up. And so I heard my husband on the phone with this woman going, uh-huh, oh, she can't? Oh, really? And I'm thinking, what did he get me? Right? And then he hangs up, and I'm like, all right, I figured out he'd gotten a Groupon of some sort. So I'm like, well, what was it? You know, I'm thinking something exciting, right, that I can't do, though, because I'm 6 months pregnant, like parachuting or, you know, something.
Right.
He goes, well, you know how you said you've been having trouble going? I'm like, yeah. He goes, I got you a colonic. I said, a what? He goes, I go, no, I heard you the first time. Like, jewelry didn't cross your mind? You know, on the top list of horrible, crappy things, literally, to get your spouse, a colonic is at the top of that list. And he was really upset because he got in two, so he and I could go together.
You know, there was a skit. I don't know if you saw it, but a SNL skit. And I love Saturday Night Live. But they did a skit of two toilets that were sort of intertwined. Mm-hmm. That way, one, you know, you could be sitting one direction, and your husband or your partner would be sitting on the other one over here, mm-hmm. in the opposite direction, and you could look at each other while you're going. They had this whole thing about it, you know, hey, let's do this together. Hey, we can go to the back, you know. But that was funny. But where they come up with some, I don't know. But I've never thought of giving somebody a colonic for their...
Because you're a normal human being.
Say again.
I said, because you're a normal human being. Who thinks of giving that as a present?
Well, was he serious or was he...
No, it was completely serious.
Wow,
and
really?
He was very sincere. He was like, actually, you know what he says to me? He goes, if you think about it, Karith, it's really like a day spa for your ass.
Oh, God. You know, you know, well, I tell you what, the last time I had to go because I had surgery and I got backed up really bad and went to the ER because it was that bad. And the doctor was taking care of me and all that. Folks, this is gross. But anyway, he was taking care of me and I looked back at him and I said, you mean to tell me that you finger banged me before you took me out for lunch, you know, and he was like, oh, my God, how am I going to respond to this? That's what.
Oh, my goodness.
You know, but it's crazy though what people give. But, you know, you talk about the parachute thing. That would be fun.
Exactly.
You know, but I don't know if you could do it at 6 months pregnant, though.
No, you can't do it at 6 months pregnant. You can't go on a cruise at 6 months pregnant.
No. Probably not. But, you know, but Karith, I think that you're very, very funny. You've got a fantastic sense of humor, but also a really a serious side of you as well. And I love that. I like to get that, bring that out of people. You know, people can laugh, but they can also get so serious. Mm-hmm. Your book is something upcoming, you mentioned it. Is that on a serious note, or is that on more or less a comic note?
It you know what? It crosses the line. It's a hybrid. It's a hybrid of funny, you know, bringing out the funny, because the ridiculousness that people exude, the energy that they exert on trying to reach a state that is non-existent, trying to be perfect. Like, you know, I don't know if it's because we've been trying to keep up with the Kardashians, or we've just been watching too much TV and seeing celebrities who are, you know, trainers and chefs and plastic surgeons. And it's not just about physical, you know, being perfect. It's about, you know, trying to be the perfect mom or the perfect boyfriend, or, you know, this whole idea that if you attain perfection, then you're somehow a good person. If you don't, then you're bad, or you've done something wrong. Well, what about being human? You know, what about cutting yourself some slack, realizing that there's nothing, like, perfection doesn't exist. It's an idea that we have out there. And, you know, I'm not going to say it's all advertisers, because we obviously accept the message, but, I mean, the advertising world exists to, you know, to make people kind of feel bad about themselves. That's why you need their product, you know?
You know what? You're right. You are so right. Hey, can I quote that? That's a good quote. It is. When you're looking at advertisers and, you know, make people think that they're really bad, you know, or that they, you know, are really ugly, and they need this product to look good. You know, interesting. But how would you say that would react with comedy? Is it maybe because people are boring? You live such a boring little life. You need to come to my show and listen to me make you laugh.
Well, I think most people want to feel good. I think most people want to laugh. I think, you know, real life sucks.
Yes, it does.
You know, the day-to-day ins and outs, you know, probably aren't too hysterical, which is why you need to remember to bring laughter into your life. And actually, that's another thing that I do. I have something called Laughter Boot Camp that I take to corporations and to organizations to teach people how to laugh again about the various things that happen in their lives. Because if you look hard enough, anything can be funny. I mean, look at sitcoms. Think about how many sitcoms that have ever existed that, you know, have like a funeral scene, right? And it's usually one of the funniest parts of the show. And death, it obviously isn't funny, but we have to laugh at those things so that we get through them.
That's, you know, true. You know, it is a real life experience. Life or death, of course. There are, you know, just waking up in the morning, that alone is a gamble. People want to talk about gambling. Well, it's a gamble every time you leave your house.
Mm-hmm.
Every time you go to the bank or go to the store, it's a gamble. A, are you going to get there? B, are you coming home?
Yeah.
You know, so, but I think that you are on the right track, absolutely, and I am elated to have you on as today's guest. Again, you had mentioned your website. It's Karith.com?
Uh-huh, Karith.com, K-A-R-I-T-H.
And what are, do you have any upcoming plans for any shows in the city or Washington or Baltimore between now and, say, the first of the year?
Oh, goodness. Well, the movie that I mentioned, Can We Take a Joke, is coming out. If you look that up online, you can see where they're working on distribution. I'm trying to get some stuff in Dallas before the holidays are up, because I'll be going home. And we'll see what this awesome manager is getting me. Actually, I will be in Pennsylvania. That's not true. I booked myself in Pennsylvania. At Penn State, February, like Valentine's Day weekend, the 12th and 13th.
Wow.
Yeah, so if anybody has any interest in my shows, or you can follow me on Facebook, I'm also on Twitter, and of course you email me, Karith.com. And I'll be doing a speaking series, actually, speaking of ad agencies, at a pretty major ad agency for a few weeks. On diversity and inclusion. So
now, one final question for you. You talk about Dallas. I mean, I was the Dallas area. I was born in Dallas.
Oh, really?
But I was smart enough to leave. But anyway, I was born in Dallas several years ago, and But what I have found is, depending on where you are in the country, depends on the type of humor that you find, or if you're going to find educated people or people who really just don't give a rat's behind about anything. Do you find that as well?
You know, there is a saying, you know your audience, right? And there are audiences who differ, of course, by region, by certain levels of intellect. You know, a college audience is going to be a little bit different than a local bar. You know, I try to just read my audience to see where they are. Like, I have one joke that probably one of the only blue jokes I have in my act, and you know, the punchline has to do with a duvet, right? And in many parts of the country, they have no idea what a duvet is, so I have to change it to bedspread, you know?
You know, that is funny. They use that term in England a lot, the duvet. You know, make it sound really exquisite, you know? And I mean, it's funny. But, you know, I don't know. But when I go to the South, and by the way, speaking of travel, this was actually in the news today, but a lot of states are requiring, if you are going to be flying from one state to another, beginning the first of next year, at least the first part of next year, maybe by February, but they are either going to require that you have an enhanced driver's license to fly or a passport in the United States. Do you know anything about that?
That's true. I've never heard of this. Interesting.
Yep. So I don't know.
What are children supposed to do?
Say again, children? I guess passport. I don't know, but Washington State is one of them. We have the enhanced driver's license here, which is...
And what do they mean by enhanced? What is that about?
That actually, what it does is it takes the place of a passport if you're going to Canada or Mexico.
Okay.
Then to show your driver's license and you're done. But, you know, versus a conventional, traditional passport. But they are looking at implementing passport laws in the United States to fly from Seattle to Dallas or New York to Dallas or wherever else if you're going one state to the next. So I didn't know if you're up to date on that or not, but that's what they're talking about.
Interesting. It sounds a little Big Brotherish to me.
It does, doesn't it? Now that's something to make fun of, and I love, anyway, Big Brother, that series. I love Big Brother. Not the American one. That one is boring. It is just boring to me. But the UK version, yes, that is very, very funny. Catch that on YouTube. Anyway, listen, Karith, hey, it has been an honor to have you on. It truly has.
Well, thank you for having me.
And I wish you the best in the world, and I'd love to have you back again.
Thank you.
Especially when your book comes, you know, when it's being published and
you
all that.
You're perfect and happy. Mm-hmm.
Oh, I would love to do that. You know, I talk to a lot of book authors about their books, about their projects, movies, movie directors, and all this, and it's always interesting to get the before and the after look at it. Like, oh, this is upcoming, and now here it is. You see what I mean?
Absolutely. Well, if anybody in your audience, you know, works with schools or colleges or universities or has a company that needs some kind of like diversity and inclusion training, you know, please feel free to reach out, and I'll have my agent get in touch with them. Because it's important. We need to talk about these things, and we need to, you know, let people understand that, you know, we're all entitled to the same things, respect, acceptance, and love.
I completely agree, and I tell you what, I'll keep you posted, and if I run into anything, I'll let your agent know, you know, or try to get a hold of you one way or another, that way. So, excellent.
Thank you.
We just never know who's going to be watching or listening to podcasts. You know, that's the cool thing about it. But anyway, listen, it is great to have you on, and we'll talk to you real soon.
Thank you so much. Have a great weekend.
You too. Bye-bye for now. Ladies and gentlemen, Karith Foster, it is a joy. It really is to have Karith on, and I am elated. How about you all? Good grief. You know what? Talking about somebody that is very talented, somebody that has a good sense of humor and a good head on her shoulders, I think she does. Absolutely. Folks, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice, your opinion, they matter. We're going to take a short break. We will be back with more of the show. Online, you can visit us at robertchristianshow.com. And folks, it is a joy having you all with us today. You know what? I like to get people in on the show, like our guest today, Miss Karith Foster, because actually for two reasons. One of them is for the funny end of it. And everybody enjoys a good laugh. Everybody enjoys the opportunity to kick back, put your feet up, let your hair down. But there again, on a serious note, because it is people like her, it is people like our guest that does have a fantastic view on the world. And a desire to change the world, even one person at a time, one moment at a time. And for anybody that has paid attention to any of the live shows that I've done over the years, I've always said that I prefer the movers and the shakers in this world. In other words, those people that aren't so stuck up, they aren't so aggravated by aggravation. They are not so mad because of madness or angry because of anger, but because they find something unique, they find something that needs to be talked about, and they address it. She is a stand-up comic, motivational speaker, actress, and author. She has been on ABC television, BET, Bravo, MSNBC, WABC there in New York, and many other outlets. Comedy Central. I think it's great. But folks, it is people like Karith that make the world go round, wouldn't you say? So once again, I want to thank Karith for that. And also, you know what? This upcoming hour on the show, now we want to talk about something funny. Well, let's talk about this. The Republican debate, and I don't know how many of you watch this, but the Republicans, to me, it was a bit comical. Not a comic relief, but a bit comical, because the Republicans got very angry with CNBC, because they said, you know what, we don't want to have the upcoming debate on NBC proper because of the way that the Republicans were entreated at the last debate. Well, we are going to be getting into this, folks, hook, line, and sinker, the Republican debate. And ask the question, did any clear winner actually emerge? We are going to be talking about it. And I want to know what you, of course, think about it. Folks, I don't know what it is about me, but when it comes to the world of politics or something as cynical as that, and it really is, I look at it with humor. So if you haven't heard a humorous look at the Republican debate, the clown car, stay tuned. But you know what? I look at it with humor. I have to. Some people say, you know, hey, I can't stand politics. It's because people don't understand the politics. People don't understand how it works or why it works. But you know what? There is an awful lot at stake in the United States. There's an awful lot at stake around the world, folks. And so sometimes what we do need to do, really, is to look at this with a little humor, with a vibrant viewpoint, be vocal, and be willing to express our thoughts, be willing to express our concern. Now, granted, there are an awful lot of things that we can be so concerned with in this world, but ladies and gentlemen, sometime we can be so concerned about issues of the day, they blind us. It's like can't see the forest because of the trees. And sometimes what we need to do is to kick back and look at it from a different perspective, look at it from a different frame of mind. So some people, they look at politics and they say, oh, that is so boring. Oh, my God. The world of politics, that is a freaking bore to me. But you know what? It used to be boring to me until I found out the way that the game is actually played. And you think that the world of politics is not a game, you have something coming. Because you're going to find out by the end of today's show that, yes, in fact, it is. It's a game. It is a political game. It is a game that rich men play. And the poor people, the 99%, all right, they are the ones, we are the ones that are the pawns on this game. How many pawns is it going to take to get the king? Or how many pawns is it going to take to get the queen? How many pawns is it going to take to get in harm's way for me to get what I really want? I'm not worried about it because I've got millions of them. I mean, folks, it is a ridiculous way to look at it, but it's true. Karith Foster, I think that she has a great envision. She is a visionary, taking a message beyond just being funny. And if you haven't seen her, again, it's Karith.com, her website. But if you have not, if you've never paid attention, or you'd like to, and you want to know more about her, look her even up on YouTube. Love YouTube. She's got some funny stuff up there. But you know what, folks? It is people like her, again, that I say. It's people just like her that have a good message, a solid message, and they're able to deliver it. Isn't that awesome? So where does Karith fit into the world of politics? You know what? I don't know. I can't speak for her. But I will say this, that in life, everything is a gamble. Like I said earlier on, folks, in the interview with her, everything in life, it is a gamble. It's either you're going to gamble with your health by eating certain things. And now they're saying that bacon, God loved the bacon. But they're saying, oh, bacon, don't eat bacon because it can cause cancer. Don't eat red meat. Don't eat meat, period, because it can cause cancer. If we really understood what kind of chemicals are in our meat, our food products, okay, that includes the vegetarian. What kind of chemicals are used? I mean, it's amazing. Wow. Nonetheless, hey folks, we have upcoming on the Robert Christian Show. Where is that note again? Okay, here it is. Upcoming real soon, we have the liberal redneck. Very funny guy, Joe is his name. We're going to be getting with Joe. Laughing, yes, I'm getting a redneck philosophy. We need to have a redneck philosopher on. Fred Greiger is also coming on. He's a financial advisor. Ooh, yep. And then we have a spiritual medium. This is going to be a very interesting show that Marilyn is scheduled for. Lovely. And then we have special guest, folks, special guest beyond Marilyn. Of course, she's a special guest. But we have more special guests. You know what? We're actually booked up, folks, until, wow, we're booked up. The calendar says no more, which is awesome. So come December, by the end of December, we are absolutely booked up. What in the world happened? I don't get it. I don't know. But you know what? We make the world, folks, a better place one moment at a time, one day at a time. Yeah, we do. And if I could do anything that is going to encourage you, the viewer, you, the podcast listener, we want to encourage you. We want to strengthen you. We want to make more out of that what is. We can argue the points of what is so bad and so wrong, so elongated, so corrugated in the world, so narrow-minded. We can argue about all kinds of things. And we can point out the bad, the evil McCoys of it all. Anybody can do that. But it takes wisdom. It takes a solid mind. It takes a right heart. The correct heart chakra, right? The intuition. It takes something more than just to say, oh, everything is bad, but to look through the bad and find the good. To find the gem in life. We all can find that gem in life. We all can do something more out of life than what we've ever thought of. Our dreams, our ambitions, our goals. Let us continue on with them, folks. Let us continue on making the best out of life and encouraging somebody else in their own life. I'm Robert Christian. Stay tuned with more of the Robert Christian Show upcoming right here. And again, visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. The only address you need. It's out of this world. Stick around for hour two of the Robert Christian Show. Live from Washington. We will be back right after this.